specialized research project. So if you're registered anywhere in arts and sciences, it's two courses you can take. Architecture, mapping for architecture, urbanism, humanities, and data visualization for architecture, urbanism, and the humanities. And then we're running the seminar, Conflict Urbanism, which is a four-year sequence, each time collaborating with someone else in the humanities. And this time it was really fun with Lydia Liu, who is working on this project, Language Justice. So Conflict Urbanism, as a fellow Hectonian, you're very familiar with the topic of conflict, and I, even though last semester our seminar was called Conflict Urbanism in Aleppo, the project is not only about war, but about the everyday conflicts that emerge in cities because of globalization, rural urban migration, political structures such as post-apartheid South Africa and pre-apartheid South Africa. and so, do you want to talk a little bit about language justice?
Just a few words.
Okay. And you can look at it if you go to the Center for Spatial Research, which this grant helped establish, and just search the term conflict urbanism, you'll find all the work from last semester and also all the tutorials open to the public and downloadable.
Just a few words. Welcome. And you flew all the way from Cape Town.
Welcome from Amsterdam.
This is a rare occasion when we get to hear from someone, from a scholar from South Africa. And this is, as Laura said, a lecture series that goes with our course, a seminar that we jointly conduct. The Institute for Comparative Literature and Society, which I direct, received a different grant, also a Mellon grant, to support a seminar that we're going to kick off in the fall of this year. So this is a very new project that emphasizes the need to pay attention to the problem of English monolingualism and its connection with globalization. We are very interested in questions of linguistic diversity that are closely linked with questions of biodiversity. And we're also very much interested in the digital technology and its connection with all of these issues having to do with conflict urbanism and the immigrant communities, refugee populations, and things like that, as you can see how urgent these issues are. So, Michelle, you want to say a few words?
As both Laura and Lydia mentioned, this is a highly interdisciplinary seminar and course and all of this, and because of that, it's with special excitement that I have the honor to welcome Dr. Anna Deumert to the Conflict Urbanism Language Justice Seminar. Anna is a professor at the University of Cape Town and is one of the leading researchers of the sociolinguistics of computer-mediated communication. Her work on globalization, mobile communication, and multilingualism brings together the themes of the seminar and situates it very much in a multilingual and a multicultural world. So while her work is often considered sociolinguistics, it also spans anthropology and sociology and economics and much, much more. And there are a few researchers I know who tie these themes together as seamlessly as Anna does. So the title of her talk tonight is Together We Can Create a Freer Future, Digital Language Activism, Challenging and Reproducing Hegemonies. And please join me in welcoming Professor Deumert.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So first of all, I would like to thank you all, and especially you, for coming and for inviting me to speak here. It is my first time in New York. And I really wish I could have come under different and happier political circumstances. Yet it is particularly apt under these circumstances to speak about language justice, activism, and digital media, a potent combination when it comes to resistance politics. The title of my talk comes from a digital activism project, the Runa Simipi project, which aimed to create open software in Quechua, a South American language. The project's manifesto is keenly aware of the fact that multilingualism in new media contexts entails not only functional expansion, in this case, the development of software as well as associated terminologies, but also transforms the ideological valuation of a language. Diverse languages emerge as part of the contemporary world and as relevant for the future. And this move towards digital multilingualism is positioned as politically transformative. The manifesto states, the very act of using Quechua, oops, something happened.
How did that happen? This is very strange.
Okay, this is art. This is digital, this is visual art. It's only part of the manifesto. I can send you my slides, which have the full manifesto, and we just hope that Mac doesn't decide to delete things suddenly. I was just wondering why everybody's looking kind of strangely at the slides. Okay, I'll read the important part.
Can I get a resolution? It actually is on this one as well, so maybe let me just try. If I can get out. Yeah, no, it doesn't stop because here it's there.
It's
there.
Yeah.
So, slideshow, place on start. And now it's there.
Good. Sometimes Mac seems to be doing these things. Yeah. Anyway, the important part here is the very act of using Quechua software is a political statement. Together, we can create a freer future. So, this is where the title comes from. In 2012, the initiative was taken up by Mozilla, who partnered with the project to translate the web browser Firefox into Quechua. Fast forward 5 years, Mozilla is still not translated into Quechua, or rather it is, as is the case for many languages online, partially translated. I hope you can see it there, I've circled it. A few words have been localized, images, the one word, settings, the other word, all the other words remain in English. For those wishing to access digital media in a non-dominant language, this kind of partial translation is a well-known experience. A visually arrested interface showing traces of activity and activism, but remaining quite far removed from the desire for full localization. And if you just want to have this experience yourself, go to your Facebook profile and put it into Quechua, isiXhosa, or isiZulu, and you will see exactly this kind of partial experience of multilingualism, always mixed up with lots of English. At the end of 2016, so just a short while ago, Mozilla started a new initiative to translate the interface into Quechua, and things might be changing, which is one of the things about the digital space, or they might not be changing, since they haven't been changing since 2012. Keeping this example in mind, the core question I wish to explore in the next 40 or so minutes is, can digital technology, its historical bias notwithstanding, become a tool for the political empowerment of the speakers and writers of hitherto marginalized languages? In answering this question, I want to take a closer look at everyday linguistic practices online, as well as the various types of sociolinguistic activism that help speakers and writers to claim, that is to stake out, visibility for their languages and ways of speaking in the global arena. In the final section of the paper, I will look at a specific example which talks more directly to the focus of the broader lecture series, how urban spaces and their ways of speaking can leave traces online, not only across space, but also across time. An important concept when thinking about language online is visibility, and its counterpart, invisibility. Writing, which is core to digital language engagement, makes languages not only hearable or present, but grants them a form of materiality, and thus turns language into visual culture. And in understanding visibilities and invisibilities, I further draw on Nancy Fraser's work on the politics of recognition, of social, cultural, and linguistic resources, identities, and beings, and the politics of redistribution, of economic resources. Fraser sees recognition and redistribution as a duality, a dialectic.
There can be no recognition without redistribution and vice versa. Both recognition and redistribution are vital for full social participation, for overcoming subordination, and thus also for visibility online. Paying attention to questions of maldistribution and redistribution, to the political economy of communication, helps us to develop what Adele Hines envisaged as the goal of the ethnography of speaking. In the 1970s, that is, and this is how he formulated the goal of the work of social linguists and linguistic anthropologists, to understand the origins and foundations of inequality between speakers. A similar line of thinking was pursued by the sociologist Pierre Bourdieu when he argued that it is not enough for linguists to merely study the human ability to speak and communicate. Rather, and I quote him, an adequate science of discourse must establish the laws which determine who, the factor and the juror, may speak to whom and how. And in communication studies, Vincent Moscow has argued that all communication, all sign-making, all semiotic activity is economically structured and that people have to use physical resources to engage in such activities. Thus, while talk is never cheap, it is especially costly when it comes to digital media. Participation and recognition depend directly on having access to and being able to purchase hardware, software, and data. And this ability of access in digital media is unequally distributed among people. The inequality of access to digital artifacts has been referred to as the digital divide, or more accurately, as digital social inequalities, a term which emphasizes the interlinking of global social inequities and digital access. In the first instance, digital access is a function of economic prosperity. Wealthier countries show higher levels of technology access, poorer countries show lower levels. The pattern is similar within countries. Individuals with higher incomes have more access than those with lower incomes. Access is further structured according to variables such as age, education, disability, language, rural and urban residence, as well as race and ethnicity. In addition, general literacy skills, computer literacy skills, as well as opportunities to practice these skills are important for using the technology successfully. These caveats are important when considering the techno-utopian rhetoric of scholars such as Henry Jenkins, who has argued that a new participatory media culture emerged online, characterized by low barriers to artistic expression and civic engagement. From a global perspective, we need to ask, low barriers for whom? Who is able to speak and write online? Who participates in the new participatory culture? The International Communications Union noted in the conclusion to the 2016 annual report that at this point in time, the internet is both pervasive and absent. Can I just read out this quote? People no longer go online, they are online. An increasingly ubiquitous, open, fast, and content-rich internet has changed the way many people live, communicate, do business. Yet, many people are still not using the internet, and many users do not fully benefit from its potential. We thus live in contradictory times, in times of social injustice. For some, mobile communication is ever present in their lives, and assume that is the case for most of us. For others, these forms of communication remain out of reach. Global statistics show not only the continuing growth of digital access, but also the persistence of non-access. So I'm not talking just about limited access, but about non-access, people who have no access at all to the internet. More than half of the world's population remains entirely offline, according to the 2016 data. And this is sometimes kind of hard to believe when you live in a highly connected country, like the United States, where you have 80 to 90% internet access. But these countries, so it's not very clear, you can kind of, the rest of the world is a bit dark, but you have below 10% internet access in many other countries. So these people are unable to participate in the much celebrated network society. Left out of digital connectivity are especially countries in sub-Saharan Africa, as well as countries in South Asia and Southeast Asia. And this is referred to as the archipelago of disconnection by internet researchers. And this is where we have, internet penetration rates of well below 10%. These global patterns are relevant when it comes to questions of linguistic visibility online. Only those who are online will be able to produce and consume digital content in the languages they speak. And those parts of the world which show the greatest diversity of languages remain also those with least access to the internet. Let us turn our attention to the practices of those who are online. And my focus will be on Africa because this is where I live and work and do my research. Despite overall low levels of access, there exist important pockets of connectivity in Africa, especially among urban professionals and students. What do people do when they are online? As noted earlier, I want to look at everyday practices as well as more deliberate language activism. The idea of the everyday has been important in media anthropology and social linguistics. The digital is seen not simply as a space for regular interaction and sociability, but also as a space for alternative aesthetic moments and semiotic creativity. The everyday is self-evident and elusive at the same time. Crucially, as noted by Yuriko Saito, the everyday is that which we experience and construct ideologically and interactionally as everyday. She writes, "The most important factor for the purpose of everyday aesthetics is not so much an inventory of objects and activities, but rather the typical attitude we take towards them. For many of us, this includes digital media, objects and practices that, for those who have ample access, are no longer exceptional or special, but ordinary, deeply embedded in the routine flow of life. To recall the earlier description, we no longer go online, we are online." In Texting Africa, myself and my colleague Kristen Falk-Alexander approach everyday digital creativity from the perspective of verbal art and performance. And in this, we follow other media researchers, such as Yannis Androtsopoulos, who wrote about heteroglossic performances, Brenda Darnand, who linked performance and play, and Jenny Sundin, who looked at the performance of identities online. In theorizing performance and verbal art, I draw, like many others, on the work of the folklorist and linguistic anthropologist Richard Bellman. And he wrote in an early paper in the 70s, "Fundamentally, performance as a mode of verbal communication consists in the assumption of responsibility for an audience for the display of communicative competence. Performance calls forth a special attention to and heightened awareness of the act of expression. Responsibility to an audience and heightened awareness to the act of expression are key phrases in this definition. Adopting a poetic and performance perspective means that we consider digital communication not simply as communication about things and about the world, which we as linguists call the referential function of language or the denotational function of language. Digital communication is much more than an exchange of information. It is also a form of communication and interaction that is experienced as expressive, enjoyable, and pleasing, where language is on display for others to see, to appreciate, and to evaluate. It is visual culture, as I said earlier, as well as verbal culture." This is a Facebook example from South Africa. It was posted in 2008 to a group called "How Many Xhosas Are There on Facebook?" You see, Xhosa is one of South Africa's main languages. It has official recognition and around 8 million speakers, just that you have a bit of background. The stance of the post is activist. We must talk isiXhosa. The language is carefully chosen to portray the persona of a pure umXhosa. Mixing with other languages, especially English, is avoided. And the performance of linguistic skill, as well as its anti-colonial political stance, is appreciated by the audience. Kweku, wow. Digital writing, like all writing, is often crafted and displayed for an audience. This is the case especially in public spaces, Facebook, but also Twitter. Consider this example. Posted just a few weeks ago during the Africa Cup of Nations, I don't know how many soccer fans we have here and who watch the Africa Cup. The writer hashtags four Senegalese languages, Mandinko, Wolof, Pular, and Suninke, in a multimodal performance of national unity and celebration. Hashtags and emojis are central to the performance frame, as well as to the visual enjoyment of digital writing. Aesthetic crafting is also visible in interactional data. This exchange comes from a private interaction between university-educated male friends in Accra, Ghana. They are all in their 30s. This particular segment, involving only two participants in the larger group chat, is about a spelling mistake. An extra O was added to a name on a public announcement, so that's what happened before this exchange. And the tone is playful. Samson sees a squawku, who responds with laughter and mock denial. Nah. The exchange is filled with conversational interactions. O, kora, pa, ha ha ha. All lengthened for emphasis and expressivity. We also see creative and visually marked respellings, kheret, forget it, and pp for peer pressure, as well as the use of the Gar pidgin expression, gubar shot, to make a mistake. And I think with this explanation, you should be able to understand what's happening there. Audience appreciation is not overly articulated here, but it is evident, so there's no cheering, there's no kweku, there's no applause for the beauty of what is being produced. But it's evident in the ways in which the banter is picked up and continued, in which expressivity is echoed and intensified. The three examples come from different digital platforms, Facebook, Twitter, and WhatsApp, and from different countries, South Africa, Senegal, and Ghana. They're illustrative of the kind of data we see when we study everyday mobile communication. Interactions and postings such as these make diverse ways of speaking visible online. Isikasa, French, Senegalese languages, Ghanaian pidgin, and Akan discourse markers. They also draw attention to an important aspect of linguistic visibility. Linguistic forms are not necessarily visible as languages, bound and well-defined entities with names such as Isikasa, English, and Akan, but they are frequently mobile and fragmented. They appear as linguistic resources, as bits of language that can be moved around. Another example is given on this slide, a Facebook status from South Africa combining local slang, Northern Sotho, and English. The writer is a young South African woman who posts exclusively via a mobile phone. All these examples reflect what Ophelia Garcia and Lee White call translanguaging. This term refers to the ways in which people draw on their entire sign repertoire in expressing themselves. Speakers and writers create meaning and diverse forms of verbal art, not by speaking a language. So in this example, the speaker cannot be said to be speaking a language. She's not speaking Northern Sotho, she's not speaking English, and she's also not speaking slang. But she translanguages, she's doing language, and it's in this doing language, so the idea of languaging as doing language. So this, I think, is a shift which is happening in linguistics, where we move away from people speaking a language to people doing something, their language, they're creating language as they speak. And the trans prefix is important. It emphasizes the ways in which multilingual practices are both trans-systemic, that is integrated into one semiotic system and not seen as belonging to different demarcated languages, as well as transformative and transgressive. These translingual practices bring about new representations of language and are literally on the other side of what linguists, since Ferdinand de Saussure, thought language to be. An object, long, that was the idea of, or still is the idea of traditional linguistics, and not a practice. At other times, however, we see processes of reification, that is, ideological positionings of what a particular language is, what it looks like, sounds like, its boundaries, and its identity. Reification was visible in the Isikasa example from Facebook, and it's something we see regularly on Wikipedia, a multilingual online project that is deeply invested in the ideology of languages as well-defined objects. Wikipedia, which is among the top 10 websites globally, has been described as a commons. Unlike Facebook and Twitter, it is non-profit and thus located outside the capitalist markets of most social media applications. Wikipedia is also an important multilingual space, providing content in close to 300 languages at the moment. Because of its popularity and presence, Wikipedia provides an important testing ground for understanding the challenges of creating a global multilingual online space. As noted by Mark Graham and his colleagues at the Oxford Internet Institute, Wikipedia is an important platform from which we can learn whether the internet facilitates increased participation across cultures, provided that people have some access, or reinforces existing global hierarchies and entrenched power dynamics. Wikipedia is a rich source of research also because of its extensive archive. history and discussion pages enable researchers to trace the emergence of each article. And debates on community pages allow for analysis of underlying discourses and ideologies. This archive, the archive that Wikipedia provides us with, makes it possible to understand how articles are edited and revised, how fact sources and authorities are debated and agreed upon, how different choices, including language-related ones, are made by different contributors, how different ideological stances compete with each other, and how some of them become temporarily or more permanently encoded in encyclopedic entries. When looking at Wikipedia from a sociolinguistic perspective, global hierarchies and entrenched power dynamics are clearly visible. English and other large languages dominate article statistics, and this is indicated in column 2 and 3 on this slide. However, European minority languages, subordinated, yet used by people who live in economically affluent societies with ample digital access, are also fairly visible on Wikipedia. They're actually doing quite well. Their presence supports the idea that digital media can, in principle, provide new spaces for the representation of linguistic diversity, if people have access. Yet for those parts of the world where access is restricted, we see the opposite pattern. Even large languages, and especially Africa and South America, but also Asia, remain underrepresented on Wikipedia. It is worth noting that the relatively high average article number for Asia, where's Asia? Asia here, so it looks quite high, but it's largely the result of averaging from the Chinese and the Japanese Wikipedias, which are huge. So all the other Asian languages are tiny, so it's kind of a statistical issue there. The last column is quite interesting. It presents a statistic, it's a typical, it's a Wikipedia type statistic of editor per million speakers. While editor numbers are high in Europe for both minority and majority languages, so this is especially interesting, how many editors you have per million speakers for minority languages in Europe. So there's a huge activism going on for European minority languages, especially if you compare them with the statistic for Africa. So they are low in Africa, South America, Oceania, and importantly, this brings you to the local context, also North American languages, North American Indian languages, which are spoken in communities of First Nation languages, where patterns of access mirror those of the global south. And in the following discussion, I want to zoom in on two Wikipedia projects, the Wikipedia Masri, written in Egyptian Arabic, and the Isikosa Wikipedia. Launched in 2008, Wikipedia Masri is the first and so far only Wikipedia in a colloquial variety of Arabic, Egyptian Arabic. Ivan Panovich described Wikipedia Masri as an ideological project that seeks to forge discursively an Egyptian national identity that is neither Arabic nor Muslim. And in doing so, it has expanded vernacular writing into a new domain, online collaborative knowledge production. However, to be allowed to do so, to start a new Wikipedia, Egyptian writers first had to prove that they spoke indeed a language and not a dialect. And when it comes to languages, Wikipedia only allows one kind of proof. One needs an ISO 6393 code. And unless you're a linguist, you probably don't know what an ISO 6393 code is. The history of these codes, of ISO codes for languages, is closely linked to missionary linguistics, especially the work of the Summer Institute of Linguistics, SIL, which in turn has ties to Wycliffe Bible translators. And without going into details here, the intriguing parallels between missionary localization project, the Bible in every language, and knowledge-based localization projects, Wikipedia in every language. The authority for the assignment of ISO codes is the Ethnologue, which is published by SIL International. The Ethnologue works together with the International Organization for Standardization, ISO, so that's where the ISO comes from, in creating an international standard for language names. So ISO codes, which are assigned by the Ethnologue, which belongs to SIL, and which in turn works together with an International Organization for Standardization, so these are just administrative labels. They're meant to create order in a multilingual world. It is an example of what James Scott calls seeing like a state, a discursive ideological project which interpolates collectives, makes them legible, and therefore governable. Social linguists have always been skeptical about languages as bounded entities, as things. Ulrich Weinreich, famous linguist, quipped already in the 1940s, that a language is a dialect with an army and a navy. And today, from the perspective of Wikipedia, we can say a language is a dialect with an IS 6393 code. Egyptian Arabic has an ISO 6393 code, and requesting a Wikipedia edition was thus in principle possible. However, when the request was issued in 2008, there was resistance. A number of Wikipedians argued strongly that, an valid ISO code notwithstanding, the standard Arabic Wikipedia should be the reference point for everyone. Otherwise, it would open the door for an endless number of Arabic Wikipedians. One participant in the discussion articulated his concern by drawing up such a list with a great sense of worry. And I cite his list: Tunisian Arabic Wikipedia, Algerian Arabic Wikipedia, Saudi Arabic Wikipedia, Emirati Arabic Wikipedia, and even more, we would have a Tunisian Arabic of Tunis Wikipedia, a Tunisian Arabic of Nepal Wikipedia, a Tunisian Arabic of Djerba Wikipedia, and a Tunisian Arabic of Sfax Wikipedia. What we see here is the fear of fragmentation, social and linguistic, that raises its head. The desire for unity and the anxiety as to what might happen once we allow diversities free reign. Supporters of the Wikipedia mastery countered by declaring Egyptian Arabic a language that is distinct from Arabic, combining creatively Egyptian, Coptic, Greek, Italian, Turkish, and of course Arabic. The meaning of Arabic is thus reframed and critiqued, and reflections on how to write Egyptian were part of the early discussions. In 2008, the following idea, and the first one, was suggested. Writers should use layperson's terms and a mixture between Egyptian slang and Arabic. This is an interesting statement. For all its nationalist impetus, the language activism of Wikipedia Masri is open to diverse ways of writing. There is no detention to define or unify Masri. While the dialect of Cairo is acknowledged as prestigious, it is not prescribed. Translingualism, I would like to suggest, is one of the forms that language activism takes in late modernity, especially perhaps in the post-colony. We see a broad acceptance of heteroglossic practices and an absence of policing cultural linguistic expression. Discourses of purism and authenticity are conspicuous by their absence. The only strategy that writers seem to follow consistently is to distance themselves from standard Arabic. Borrowings from English or creative neologisms are generally preferred over established Arabic words. Let me move from the Wikipedia Masri, the Egyptian Arabic Wikipedia, a growing Wikipedia with over 15,000 articles, to the Isikosa Wikipedia, a small Wikipedia with only around 600 articles. Isikosa, to repeat, is not a small language. As I mentioned earlier, it has official status in South Africa and is spoken by more than 8 million people. The Isikosa Wikipedia was established early, already in 2003, 2 years after the start of Wikipedia, and the contribution pattern for the Isikosa Wikipedia is very different to that from the Wikipedia Masri. Whereas contributors to Wikipedia Masri are speakers of Egyptian Arabic, many of the contributors to the Isikosa Wikipedia live in the global north, and acknowledge on their talk pages that they have only very limited or even no knowledge of Isikosa. They are not members of the Isikosa, of the Amakosa diaspora, but white Wikipedians who are driven by a curious desire to assist in the growth of the Isikosa Wikipedia. User V is one such user. Hi, my name is V, and I'm an English-speaking American from Chicago. I'm interested in improving the Kosa Wikipedia. I can look up names in a Kosa English dictionary and start pages with a stub tag and add a photo and link it to existing languages. And below this quote is a language she created. It's a bit, I hope you can see it. It's a picture of, I don't know who wears such pajamas still, but they look a bit old fashioned, but it's e-pajama completed with an added photo. And such stubs entries are not unusual, they're very common. Now you get your first lesson in this Kosa. Ikati and Ikofu. Ronald Reagan, and television. These entries resemble an illustrated dictionary for second language learners rather than an encyclopedia for native speakers. It is a curious case of other-directed language activism. While Wikipedia Masri can be described as a project of linguistic emancipation, contested and challenged, but nevertheless moving along with involvement from native speakers, is because that Wikipedia is in large parts a simulacrum, an image that bears only an indirect relationship to reality. In this case, the realities of isiXhosa as spoken, experienced, desired, and performed by its speakers. And in doing so, the isiXhosa Wikipedia reproduces relations of power and inequality. It reinscribes existing hierarchies, affirms the realities of global digital audience labor, and recontextualizes old colonial tropes of the white man's burden. Thus, while many of the contributors to the isiXhosa Wikipedia lack linguistic knowledge and proficiency, they make up for it with passion and enthusiasm and a deep-seated wish to help. And I cite another user, user A, "Unfortunately, I don't speak isiXhosa, but I'm keen to help the isiXhosa Wikipedia's development. I'm passionate about the dream of seeing Wikipedias in each person's mother tongue." Examples such as this show how online content creation remains embedded in old discourses and ideologies. We see discourses of benevolence, which link to discourses of voluntarism and the colonial white savior industrial complex. Not only do we see another benevolence, but also its counterpart, frustration and annoyance when those who are being helped don't behave as they should. In 2013, a proposal was made to close down the isiXhosa Wikipedia. The reason? Badly behaved and ungrateful speakers. User J writes in the motivation, "In 5 years nothing has changed, no mother tongue speakers, no progress, nothing. I think it is safe to say that speakers of this language, some 6 million of them, don't want to write an encyclopedia." Thus sometimes the digital space reproduces old hegemonies, sometimes it creates new forms of expression, allowing a sense of freedom and the enactment of creativity. Wikipedia is not one thing. The Egyptian contributors challenge inter-Arabic hierarchies. The white contributors to the isiXhosa Wikipedia reproduce old hierarchies. And things are changing as well. In 2014, a new voice joined the editors of the isiXhosa Wikipedia. That was user N, a female amaXhosa corpus linguist and writer. She was part of a university project which aimed to grow Wikipedia in African languages. User N contributed close to 400 articles in just 2 years. Articles which are competently written and substantial. So it's worth to keeping an eye on the isiXhosa Wikipedia to see what will be changing over time. And even though broad patterns of inequality and participation appear fairly predictable, the digital space is also full of surprises, of little and bigger quirks. It shows an online surplus of creative action. And I want to conclude the Wikipedia discussion with one such example. The entry Isiduku Zetu, our clan praises, or our clan names. The page, created by an amaXhosa academic during a series of community workshops in 2012, quietly subverts the ideology of Wikipedia. Isiduku Zetu does not provide, in encyclopedic style, a definition of what clan names are. Rather, the page performs visually the praises, and these praises are a form of traditional greeting and recognition for the Banga, Bengula, and Bele clans, without any explanation or commentary. The result is a form of verbal art that addresses the cultural insider, the one who knows about the importance, meaning, and structure of clan praises, rather than the cultural outsider who would, in good encyclopedic fashion, require glossary definition and explanation, something like clan praises are dot, dot, dot. On this page, we see real, artful isiXhosa, and not simulated isiXhosa. The author treats Wikipedia creatively as a public archive and repository for the preservation of oral knowledge, not as an encyclopedia. In the last part of the talk, I want to stay with the locally meaningful and the archive, looking at urban spaces and their digital traces while keeping the question of language in focus. What are the languages of the city? And how are they remediated digitally? I take my inspiration from the preface of the recently published pamphlet, Digital Rights to the City, in which Joe Shaw and Mark Graham write the following. Cities have become more than bricks and mortar. They are their digital presences, and they are constantly performed and reproduced as such. And the example I want to look at is Sophia Town, also known as Kurgan. The multi-ethnic and multilingual neighborhood of Johannesburg, which was destroyed in 1955 when the apartheid government forcefully moved its residents to Meadowlands in Soweto. Sophiatown was and is legendary. It is etched into South Africa's memory landscape. A hub of music, literature, and art, and politics in the 1940s and early 1950s, Sophiatown was one of the few places where Africans were allowed to own property, and an influential middle class developed. At the same time, Sophiatown contained parts that were slum-like, overcrowded, and impoverished, plagued by high levels of crime. Drojan Balvini, a Kakot boy, a former member of the Americans gang in Sophiatown, compared the edgy atmosphere of this vibrant neighborhood to New York. And he says, it's like New York. There's fighting all the time. In Sophiatown, you can't stay if you can't box. So I don't know if that is the case in New York, but it seems to be the parallel. Sophiatown inspired artists, as in this poem by Bravini. Bravini links the walk of the Sophiatown Tsotsi, the name for a small-scale criminal and social rebel, a figure of fear and apprehension as well as of desire, to that of his Harlem brother, walking down Lenox Avenue. Metropolitan imaginaries. A transnational urban aesthetic is articulated here, from AmaZulu musical traditions to American blues, from Johannesburg to, again, New York. Sophiatown was artistic inspiration and political activism. The political symbolism of Sophiatown is beautifully articulated in Lewis Nkosi's book, Home and Exile, published in 1965, 10 years after the forced removals. He writes, Sophiatown was a symbol of black people's capacity to endure the worst. It was also a symbol of the arrogance, resilience, and scorn for the white suburb from which they were excluded. Sophiatown has many digital traces and representation of what digital researchers call augmented realities. For example, historical documents about Sophiatown are digitized and archived at Wits University in Johannesburg. An article about Sophiatown is available on the English Wikipedia, as well as similar articles on the Afrikaans, German, French, Italian, and Sami Wikipedias, each one created by a different set of editors, and none of them a direct translation of the other. There's also an entry on Google Maps. The original houses, if you go to Google Street View, the houses you see then, have however long been destroyed. And what is visible on Google Street View are the houses that were built for the white residents when the area was renamed Triumph. A name capturing, like few others, the arrogance of white supremacy after Africans had been removed. The area was renamed Sophiatown in 2006. And then there are traces of Sophiatown in popular culture, which in turn are digitally remediated, such as the YouTube release of the most recent album of Soil, Echoes of Kufifi. Sophiatown was not simply a place, but also a way of speaking. And the speech or lingo of Sophiatown has its own digital echoes. In the 1950s, Ken Tamba published the photo novella Baby Come Dozer, Baby Come Closer, in the pages of Drum Magazine. In writing the dialogue, he used what he called a new lingo, made up of Afrikaans, Zulu, Sotho, English, and brand new words. A few years later, in the story The Urchin, he described this way of speaking as deeply expressive, something to be enjoyed, something powerful, something intensely urban, something that is performed and performative. He writes, aside from the story, Temba, Mapala, who's the main character of the story, suddenly felt in the mood for the jargon of the townships, the near animal, amorphous, quick-shifting lingo that alarms farm boys and drives cops to all branches of suspicion. But it marks the city slicker with all its vagaries. The lingo, also referred to as Tsotsitao, the language of urban streets, not small-scale criminals, did not disappear with the end of society. It remained a social symbolic, representing the experience and voice of black people. Artists continued to use it, writers drew on it, and with Twitter, a whole process of recontextualization took place, a new layer in the digital representation of the memory of Sophiatown. Sophiatown is present on Twitter, where the language and the symbolic political universe that comes with it are used in everyday encounters, everyday interactions, creating everyday forms of verbal art and visual art. The tweet on this slide refers to Fifi, the slang name for Sophiatown, as well as a dress and bodily posture that evokes the style and persona of the past while being firmly rooted in the present. Kufifi Swear, the title of this Twitter image, links past and present urban experiences. Sophiatown is gone, but it is still there. The memory of Sophia Town cannot be thought of without the experience and trauma of the forced removals to meadowlands, an experience that was given voice in a well-known song written by Strike Vilakasi in the mid-1950s. The songs cannot be narrated, they need to be listened to, and I hope this will work.
Street smart and scared of nothing. On stakni, on skola here. We won't leave, we stay here. This is Tsotsita. The lingo cantamba wrote about, a mimetic inversion and performed mimicry of Afrikaans, the language of apartheid. This historical moment of defiance is regularly instantiated and reperformed across Twitter. On stakni, on skola here remains present in its persistence contextualization. It is sung digitally, allows for creative soccer commentary, and creates a political link between past, present, future in the context of the recent student protests at South African universities. The refrain, on spola here, we stay here, is resemioticized to express contemporary political critique. In this example, critique of the president's extravagant spending on his private homestead in Kandla. Past and present work together in creating complexities of meaning in the moment, and at the same time, they make visible local ways of speaking in the global domain of Twitter. This is not self-conscious and deliberate language activism, but playful performance which nevertheless claims space for non-dominant and indeed subversive language practices online. Tsotsitaal, the mixed urban vernacular of Sophia Town, is not a free-floating linguistic resource, but connected to and anchored in a specific social persona. In this case, the persona of the Tsotsi, rebellious, streetwise, and in defiance of middle-class propriety and any form of oppression. And remember the writing earlier from Bravili, which also talks about this resistance to oppression. In 2002, Magesh, a South African kwaito musician, released Number One Tsotsi, a song with the refrain, Ekezo Tsotsi Fontuka, meaning I'm an old style Tsotsi or I'm an original Tsotsi. This phrase, which was uttered in old style Afrikaans based Tsotsitaal, so basically a variety of Tsotsitaal, which is no longer spoken except by fairly old people, often led to numerous playful citations, including Mandela, often multimodal on Twitter. It too became a public word, so just like on Stakni on Spola here, like it's a Tsotsi Fontuka, it's kind of the idea of a public word in the sense of Deborah's Bitolnik. That is a phrase that is remembered, repeated, and quoted long after its first utterance, creating yet again connections between past, present, and future. Linguistic representation and performances of Tsotsitaal go beyond the citation of such public words. Here, in 140 characters, a short lesson takes place about appropriate greeting rituals in Tsotsitaal, and I assume everybody is familiar with Twitter that you read from the back. So you have to kind of read like Arabic in order to get the sequence in which the tweets were posted. Quite common are also interactional routines on Twitter. Again, Twitter emerges as a space of learning and performing, articulating an irrecognizable historical voice. Tsotsitaal on Twitter is a special case of language maintenance and revitalization. Tsotsitaal is passed on and remains meaningful, provides material for playful performances, yet these performances are small, partial, fragmented, and momentary. Tsotsitaal on Twitter illustrates what Mikhail Bakhtin calls chronotopes, complex time-space reconfigurations and representations in language and discourse. And before concluding, I would like to return briefly to the idea of fragments. It is a notion that I see as important theoretically and as something which is worth exploring, I think, for social linguists especially. My colleague Anna Storch recently drew my attention to Gaston Bourdieu's Rubble, The Afterlife of Destruction. I don't know if you have read it, it's a fantastic book. It is an important book that looks at the ways in which rubble and ruins shape experiences and practices. Like rubble, linguistic fragments are often the result of violence and destruction, especially in the post-colony. Yet they also reflect the creativity of people, they mean making meaning out of this rubble, out of bits and pieces of language, out of fragments. Thus, one way to think of fragmentation in language is as historical rubble. Another way to think about fragments is through the metaphor of dust, more ephemeral than rubble, located somewhere between the digital trace and the spoken word. The idea of dust is something that my colleague Nkululeko Mabandla and I have been working on in the past, and we're kind of starting a new project on it. The metaphor of dust can help us to rethink boundaries. It allows us to pay attention to fuzziness, to look at mobility and time, and it also brings into focus a desire for cleanliness and purity. Dust is to be kind of cleaned away. It's considered to be a problem. Gordillo argues that in modernity we see a bourgeois anxiety about fragmentation, what he calls a cult of full objects. At the same time, there exists the fetish of the ruin, the celebration of the remnants of the past in order to reflect the violence of colonialism and capitalism. And this is where we need to be very careful as scholars and as social scientists. The celebration of the ruin is not too far from the celebration of what has been called happy hybridity by critical scholars. Yet, the fragmented creativity of the post-colony is never a choice. It might be the only way to live with violence and trauma, to fashion a future out of it. And I think the Sophia Town and Tsotsitaal example speaks exactly to that, how these practices which are playful, which are enjoyable, which are funny, come out of a history of violence, dispossession, and destruction. Thus, to recognize this history, the violence and destruction that is inherent in the idea of fragments is integral to the politics of recognition, to return to Fraser, who I cited earlier. In conclusion, language is not just a semiotic system, a presence or an absence online, it is also an object of desire. And not all online representations of language are the same. Some are, to draw on the work of the philosopher Levi Bryant, bright objects. They attract because they relate to other objects, because they promise connectivities and relations. English is such a brightly shining object online. Dim or dark objects, by contrast, are those that remain isolated. that seem to be outside of global networks and interconnections. Shapes of luminosity are thus linked to the network potential of objects, and the network potential, of course, speaks directly to digital connectivities, to their ability to affect other objects on a global scale. Bryant suggests that in the realm of social and political theory, the notion of the subaltern being located at the margins of the world system has much in common with the idea of dark objects. He argues that, and I cite, in this regard, part of political practice would consist in diminishing the darkness of quasi-dark objects, of devising strategies to brighten or intensify their appearance in situations. Darkness and brightness are common metaphors, and made visible, given visibility, in global mappings of digital connectivity. Maps such as this are common on the internet. I'm sure you have seen them before. They are accompanied by predictable and even stereotypical headings, such as, this was a newspaper heading which went with that particular map, amazing internet map shows Africa still a dark continent. Yet why is the global south, the subaltern, always associated with darkness? From Conrad's Heart of Darkness to Bryant's dark objects to contemporary internet maps, persistent colonial imaginaries are at work here, underlying metaphors of luminosity. Brightness and darkness of languages as objects of desire and thus resources for practice and performance are historically shared. The attractiveness of English cannot be understood without consideration of its chronotopic gestation at a global scale. Yet, the brightness and darkness of an object is in the mind of the beholder, and other languages, while globally much less interconnected, much less visible from a European-American vantage point, shine brightly in local contexts, where they offer relations of a different nature, that is, relations, connectivities, of solidarity, effect, identity, resistance, and self-realization. Digital media, if one has access to them, have created new opportunities for such dark objects, those that have been historically invisible in global spaces, to begin to shine, to gather brightness, to extend beyond the local. They have created new and unique global semiotic flows and frictions, which, quite like the flows and frictions of global hip-hop, are embedded in capitalist relations of production. And with this, thank you. Oops. And look forward to questions, comments, and protestations. Thank you.
Thanks so much for coming to a great presentation. I have a question about what you think about the potential of the global commons and projects like Wikipedia. So on the one hand, it seems like projects like Mesthrie Wikipedia showed us that global commons can lead to a lot of conflict and even more marginalization of language communities. But on the other hand, it seems like the lack of access to internet in some parts of the world, like in Africa, is the reason why languages are being marginalized on these global common projects. So what's the root of the problem here? Is it that there's not enough access to language communities throughout the world, or is it rather that the logic of a global commons will always marginalize the small and lead towards a sort of dominant language group?
I think it's a mix of both in some ways. So, I mean, access is, so the one is the access, the internet access, having internet access. Another problem is, I don't know how many active Wikipedians are in this room who has ever tried to edit Wikipedia on a mobile phone. It is terrible. Mm-hmm. It's possible now, so it's only possible, I think, for the last 2 years that you actually can edit on a mobile phone, but the interface is an absolute nightmare. Now, we do know that internet connectivity in Africa is mostly mobile phone driven. Most people don't have computer access. The first encounter with the internet is on the phone. So, those are important kind of, you know, technological aspects to think about. What if it would be easy to actually do something on your phone? Would perhaps, with, you know, people edit more, do more than they do at the moment? We don't know that. But the other thing, of course, is that one of the things behind something like the Xhosa Wikipedia is this idea of that people want a Wikipedia in their language, assuming that they have this one language, which is their language, in which they want to read everything. But now if we look at particularly educated people with tertiary education in South Africa or across Africa who will make use of the Wikipedia, well, they can choose. They can read the 600-page article plus a Wikipedia, and half of the articles are nothing, create new articles, or they just go to the English Wikipedia, which they can read just as well. And so, this is also, so you know, we have to think of people who is multilingual, who is monolingual, who has this kind of investment of a Wikipedia, a Bible, or whatever the object is in their own language. So I think in that way, and of course, and the other thing is, I didn't talk about it so much, I just mentioned it very briefly, but leisure matters, having leisure time. So there is a lot of work, particularly out of the United States, on digital media and out of school literacies, where the fact that you have time, that people have time, that they access, that they have easy access, fast access, around the clock, midnight, you can wake up and do something online, and there is time to do so. Now, how many young people in developing countries, especially in poor countries, do have that leisure time where they don't have to do work on the farm, do household things, look after children, and so forth? So time is another thing which can, availability of free time, which reproduces these hierarchies as well. So who can volunteer for a project, even if you have access? So I think it's entangled, but it seems to, you know, whatever, whether it's the technology, whether it's the capitalist kind of relations of production, whether it's the language hierarchies we have, and the fact that English Wikipedia is available, it all kind of works together, and together it reproduces old hierarchies. So it seems to be very, very difficult to get away from the English dominance of the internet, which keeps being reproduced. Also by something, I mean, which I didn't speak about, but there's very interesting work on platform imperialism. So just where are the platforms that dominate the internet? And again, we see a very clear pattern. And it doesn't seem to be changing over time.
Questions?
Yes.
So, this is a long lead up to a question. So it's really interesting to me, and I've practiced this, which I'm very interested in, like, interpersonal communication on mobile devices, right? And I find it very interesting that you give the WhatsApp, the Facebook, the Twitter examples that have these, like, very rich, very identity-driven language practices, and then Wikipedia, which doesn't. Like, you know, people, like you say, people with tertiary education are oftentimes going to just read it in English because they speak English. Have you found that across the board, there's more of a drive, more of a desire for people to use, like, full to-do language in these one-to-one or one-to-few rather than this person-to-audience practices? Like making the distinction there between the addressee being a small group versus the audience being the world. Because the Egyptian Arabic Wikipedia sounds like it took off, but there's an audience there, as opposed to the cost, I can't do a lateral click, Wikipedia, which seems to be slowly growing, but by just a couple of individuals. So have you found a distinction between language practices with an addressee or language practices with an audience? And this might be putting you on the spot a little bit too much.
No, it's because there's this idea in digital media research on audience segmentation. So that although tweeting means I address the world, but I actually don't address the world. I very often, depending on kind of local practices of the way Twitter is being used, you might address only your friends. I mean, there was work on that. Every year there's a survey done on Twitter in Africa. I mean, one of the projects we have, I think this is like a big project in all social media research, is that unfortunately we often rely on industry surveys because they have access, they have the money and they have access to the data. And of course, these are not the surveys we really like to work with, but they are kind of, you know, they do tell us something. So they do work with big, you know, with Twitter, they get all the firehose, they get all the data, and then, okay, they do sentiment analysis, which we don't like, but they get a pattern. So there was a pattern, for example, that Twitter in Africa seems to work differently to Twitter in America or Europe. So one of the things was, in the early Twitter days, Twitter was actually used like SMS. People used it to
arrange going out via Twitter, although it addresses a bigger audience. So the audience gets segmented, and you have, I mean, the whole thing of Black Twitter, which clearly segments the audience. It's not addressed as the world. It's addressed a particular audience. But on Facebook, you know, anybody who is multilingual, you know, when you put a status, I mean, I know when I write a status update in German, which is my first language, then automatically I'm segmenting my Facebook audience. Instead of addressing whatever many friends I have, I'm addressing a small portion of the friends. So public versus private doesn't work neatly. Wikipedia, though, and there you're right, Wikipedia is particular because Wikipedia has, it is an encyclopedia, it's a traditional knowledge project, so the idea is you write in languages. And I think that's why the Wikipedia Mesthrie is so interesting, because it seems that they allow much more fluid language practices. It doesn't seem to be a standard language as such, as long as you're different from Arabic. That's the main thing. You just mustn't write Arabic, you must be different, it must be Egyptian Arabic. But in that, whether you write the dialect of Cairo or something else, it's okay. So there, I mean, I don't speak Arabic, so I'm relying a lot there on the work by Ivan Panovich, who is the only one I know who has written on the early days of the Egyptian Wikipedia. But this would be, you know, a fantastic project. And the other thing, of course, about Wikipedia, which I mentioned briefly, but it is a fantastic source for research, because you have the articles, you have the history pages. I don't know if any of you have ever played with the history pages. I mean, we can actually see from when the article was created, how it was changed over time. I think with the English Wikipedia, it must be a nightmare to do that, but with the Xhosa Wikipedia, because it's so small, you can actually look at every article, you can look at every version of each article, when a robot came in and changed something and tidied something up. So you can actually see how articles evolve. And then, of course, you have the talk pages of the contributors, you have the discussion pages where ideologies around knowledge are being discussed. So I don't think actually in digital research the potential of working with Wikipedia has been, you know, and how language might be changed. You know, if you look at article versions, does someone go in and just change a little bit of the language? Not a fact, not add a sentence, but it's just unhappy with the way it's worded. Well, that's really interesting for a linguist that you can kind of see these things. But I don't think it has been, and then you have all the community pages for Wikipedia. So, for example, if you want to know, I mean, for every language edition, you have the proposal for the language edition. You have people saying, yes, I support it, no, I don't support it. It goes over pages and pages. You get amazing linguistic debates happening. And just one interesting thing, when I was preparing this talk and I was looking through, it's just such a huge archive, so you can really get lost there for hours. But I found that somebody has proposed a multilingual idea. So I was very excited. I thought, wow, translanguaging. You know, I can write, you know, you can write however you want, just throw languages together, and this is going to be late modern and wonderful. Actually, it isn't. It was supposed to be something like a Pidgin English Wikipedia. So Pidgin English became a gloss for multilingual. And it wasn't Pidgin in the sense of West African Pidgin English, where we have a real language. It was kind of a simplified, weird kind of idea. Anyway, but it's a new idea, so it's interesting to see on Wikipedia how this particular proposal will develop.
With the learner English.
Yeah. I mean, another thing around languages, which is really interesting, and also I've very little written on it, is with these funny ISO 6393 codes, because that is also documented. So the ethnologue has to document. So a person writes to the ethnologue and says, I think the dialect of New York is a language, it's not English, it's New Yorkese, and it should have its own ISO 3 code. And then you put in a motivation, and then that gets discussed, and opinions are being solicited. And all that is digitally archived. So you can actually see how the decision is being taken and on the basis of what grounds that something is not a dialect, but a language, or being rejected. So there's, I mean, the archive is fantastic for all kind of questions around language politics.